Today on Carib Nation, we continue our series on Caribbean personalities who have had a lasting impact on the course of Caribbean and world history. Our program today focuses on Walter Rodney, one of the Caribbean's foremost revolutionary thinkers. Assassinated in his native Guyana in June of 1980, Rodney's teachings and example have become a rallying force for social and political change across the world. Now, we have the first comprehensive work on the life and thoughts of this brilliant son of Africa and the Caribbean, whose name is called in the same breath as Marcus Garvey, Toussaint Louverture, C.L.R. James, George Padmore, Stokely Carmichael, Eric Williams, Fidel Castro, and Che Guevara. Walter Rodney's intellectual and political thought is written by Professor Rupert Lewis, a political science lecturer at the University of the West Indies, Mona Campus, in Jamaica. Well researched and written, Professor Lewis's book is more than just a biography. It is an account of an important period of 20th century Caribbean history, sociology, and politics. So please join us as we speak with Dr. Rupert Lewis about his landmark book on the extraordinary Caribbean intellectual and revolutionary, Dr. Walter Rodney. Don't go anywhere. Carib Nation is up next. Welcome to Carib Nation. I'm David Hines. Today we focus on Walter Rodney, and I have with me in the studio none other than Dr. Rupert Lewis, professor of political science, actually political thought at the University of the West Indies in Mona. Professor Lewis, we met some time ago, a couple of months ago, at the Walter Rodney's conference in New York, and ever since then I've been eagerly awaiting this book. Let's do the usual first and ask the questions that everybody will ask. That is, how you came to write this book on Walter Rodney?
Well, David, the reason has to do with the students I teach. What you found in the 1980s is that although Walter Rodney was assassinated in June 1980, the generation of students that I taught in the late 80s, even some Guyanese students, did not really know very much about Walter Rodney, who he was, what he stood for, what his writings were about. Some, of course, had encountered how Europe Underdeveloped Africa. Jamaicans knew about his the experience in 1968, October, when he was banned, and there were mass demonstrations in Kingston. Others, when I traveled to Tanzania, knew about his Tanzanian experience. And what I wanted to do was to put together the different facets of Walter Rodney's life into one book where people could examine him both in relation to his revolutionary political activity in Jamaica, in Guyana, in Tanzania, his connection with the African liberation movements, his work as a pioneer historian of Africa, of the Caribbean, his work as an intellectual analyzing the contemporary Caribbean, the contemporary black world in relationship to Western imperialism. So to put together a portrait of Walter Rodney as a basis for a more comprehensive way of presenting him to a younger public. If I had been concerned exclusively with my own generation, it would have been a different kind of a book where you're working with people who shared your assumptions and shared your political activities. But when you're working with students who are removed from that, then you have to approach the text in a different way. And as time passes along, people are less familiar with the circumstances of the 60s and 70s, with the personalities that emerge. And therefore, you have to represent that experience, whether through Walter Rodney or through other revolutionary thinkers, in a way which enables the younger people to do their own thing in relationship to how they assess the situation in the world in which they find themselves, how they draw out their own potential, how the working people are aware of what has gone on before them. And Walter Rodney's important idea of self-emancipation as a person coming from the working people himself and being very committed to his own class of people. I think this is what I try to do in the book, to enable people to understand in a comprehensive way the varied activities of Walter Rodney.
Let me pin you down on this question that you raised in the very first sentence, and that is that a number of Caribbean people, students and people in other sectors and sections of the society, have very little knowledge of personalities who have played important roles mm-hmm. in Caribbean history. Mm-hmm. The same can be said for C.L.R. James, yes. Norman Manley, Michael Manley, Chetty Jagan, you name mm-hmm. them. George mm-hmm. Padmore is hardly known by Caribbean people. Mm-hmm. What do you think? What do you think accounts for this?
I think it has to do with the continued colonial character of our educational system, even in the Caribbean. Although there's considerable work that has been done, books that are being published now, never before have we had so many regionally published texts, there's still a need for continued valorization of our own contribution to world culture, world civilization. And that sense is not easy to develop even among ourselves, because there is this feeling of inadequacy. There's a feeling that we have not really contributed in the way that some of us are making out. There is this failure to be able to understand what are the heritages that have shaped the modern period. And hence somebody like Padmore, who is so significant for the Pan-Africanist movement in the mid-20th century, is hardly known. And you run the risk of somebody like Walter Rodney not being known sufficiently in the future. I teach a course called Caribbean Political Thought, where we try to engage that tradition, because the tradition is not, it's a Caribbean tradition, but it's also a global tradition, because it helps to shape Africa, it helps to shape people in Europe, it helps us shape a discourse and analysis and practical political activity, which we need to embrace as part of our response to the 21st century and part of our way of helping to reshape our agenda. That's the heritage that we need to draw on. So that there's a continual struggle. For example, we're involved now in a program to teach Marcus Garvey in schools to make it more comprehensive. There are elements of it, but it's all part of the same struggle to involve Walter Rodney and to try to shape an intellectual tradition, which is what I'm trying to contribute to in the book. And other people have contributed to that by virtue of their work on other individuals. But it is this self-conscious shaping of an intellectual tradition. And therefore, in the same way that the Europeans have done it, you go over the same people over and over again in order to be able to extract from their work the essential elements in order to fine-tune for their own purposes. We need to do that for our own thinkers who have really made enormous contributions.
And what is so fantastic about the 20th century Caribbean thinkers, James, Padmore, Garvey, Rodney, Fanon, they have been just not thinkers about the Caribbean region, but about the world. Mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. Rodney mm-hmm. is probably better known in Africa mm-hmm. than he is in the Caribbean. Mm-hmm. In a sense, they're universal men and women mm-hmm. who have shaped not only the history of the, helped to shape not only the history of the Caribbean, but the history of the world. Mm-hmm. What do you think, again, what do you think accounts for this kind of product coming out of the Caribbean that goes onto the world stage and act in the way that it has acted?
I think what accounts, there are two reasons. One is that small territories, in this case a small coastal part of the South American continent, in the case of Guyana, but being part of a wider framework, because it was part of the framework of the British Empire. So you're connected to India, you're connected to Africa by virtue of the populations that were placed on that small coastal strip of land. So you're involved automatically with global issues. You're involved with Britain, you're involved with continental Africa, You're involved with the Indian subcontinent. You're involved also with other parts of the world, Chinese, Asia, Portuguese people, and so on. And when you try to develop a program of reform, of change, you are involved with international issues. You can't help, because these territories have been projects of the European expansion over the last 500 years. So when you encounter this, you're also dealing also with the experience of whether Africans in Brazil or African Americans in the United States, you immediately see the similarities and the similar agendas that one needs to develop in order to liberate people, in order to develop a program of reform. So no matter what you touch, if you are to make a difference in the small situations, whether it's coastal, whether it is the continental coastal strip, or in the islands of the Caribbean, you are involved with global issues, because the projects were the early form of globalization, whereas we are now, as some people would argue, in the second stage of globalization. We are products of that first globalization, and hence our world has been a very complex world of cultures, complex world of economics, modern economic systems, complex world of trade relationships, complex world of racial aggregations, as it were, that are brought together in this project that Europe created.
When America wants to know what's happening in the Caribbean diaspora, there is one clear choice.
Hello, welcome to Carib Nation.
Both people inside and outside are
very excited about today's
program. Looking at you, I can tell that you have traveled the journey.
One television organization brings America close to the people, stories, and events that affects Caribbean life. Get close, get answers, get Carib Nation.
On any given Sunday, the Caribbean wakes up to a familiar sound. We enjoy traditional tastes. We share a friendly game, and like clockwork, we gather in a common place. And there, we hear a familiar voice.
Hello, welcome to Carib Nation.
Let's go to Rodney specifically, and go to the first part of the book where you talk about Rodney's early years in Guyana. Born in 1942, coming of age in, what, the 1950s?
1950s.
Tremendous period in Caribbean history in general, but Guyanese history in particular. Mm-hmm. How this shaped the future Walter Rodney?
Well, it shaped it, first of all, in terms of the anti-colonial movement. The movement led by the late Chedi Jagan and others. The political ferment of the 50s and the repressive character of the colonial authorities in relationship to that movement. And Walter's parents are a part of that political awakening. And therefore, his youth is shaped by these activist concerns, these concerns of trying to develop the consciousness, develop political activities. But it's also shaped by that period, which is the end of colonialism and the opening up of educational opportunities for a large number of Black and Indian people. And he takes advantage fully of the opportunities of scholarships, going straight through to the School of Oriental and African Studies, and before that, University of the West Indies. He takes full advantage of the educational opportunities that are now open with the early period of decolonization. So there's a combination there of intellectual awakening, of study, and the relationship between that and the political challenges of decolonization. That combination endures in Walter Rodney's life. So the Guyanese experience is extremely important because it brings onto the agenda of his mind this question of race. the question of black people, the question of the Indian population, the question of the way imperialism and the colonialists utilize racial division as a means of making the populations that are colonized disunited and fighting against each other. He's engaged with those issues, the use of race for reactionary political purposes, and the need to challenge that particular agenda of race. So early in his life, there is an integration between his historical investigation and his effort to connect to political struggle. Mm. And what is important about his period at University of West Indies is that in the early 60s, no African history is taught. He knows a lot about European history. He knows a lot about the Atlantic on this side of it, but nothing at all about Africa. And this is what is impelling him to say, I need to know, and sending him on this investigation of the West African, the African slave trade, mm-hmm. and its impact on the modern world.
On he goes to England, studies, became a PhD at 24 years, went to Africa for a short while.
He went to Dar es Salaam in around the end of 65, 66, and he teaches there.
Right.
But his main intention is really to return to teach at the University of the West Indies and to introduce African history there.
So he comes back to Jamaica.
He comes back to Jamaica at the start of 1968.
Uh-huh.
But he doesn't get an opportunity to teach African history, mm-hmm. Because that is aborted in terms of the formal educational system. But he spends a lot of time in the inner city communities of Kingston,
uh-huh.
and in the rural communities, reasoning with people, particularly the Rastafarians, learning from them, and also letting them know about the changes that are underway in Africa, as well as teaching them about pre-colonial African history, which was a major topic of interest at the time, because this is important for people to understand, as we now have a better understanding of the fact that our history did not begin with the plantation, mm-hmm. Did not begin with the Columbian misadventure, that one has to understand that period prior to the slave trade, prior to the 15th century.
Right.
And he does a lot of work on African civilizations, African cultures, and he finds in the poor communities of Kingston, especially among the Rastafarians, a knowledge of these things, and there is an interaction. So although he doesn't get the opportunity to teach African history to students, he has these informal reasonings and lectures which are gathered, collected in the book, Groundings
of My Brothers. There are a couple of things here. On the international scene, black power is raging here in the United mm-hmm. States of America, other parts of North America. But more importantly, here is a young academic going among poor people and talking to them about their blackness, talking to them about the Africanness. Mm-hmm. It's an affront to the ruling class in the mm-hmm, Caribbean mm-hmm. at that particular time. How did they react?
They reacted very viciously. First of all, the use of the police, the use of informers, the banning of literature in Jamaica. They banned the biography of Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. They even banned a book called Black Beauty, which had no political significance, whatever, just because it had the word black in it. They banned all the writings coming out of Cuba. There was a ban on black literature, period, coupled together with a ban on communist literature.
Mm-hmm.
And Walter Rodney, along with some other students, had visited Cuba, and this made him a target for the Jamaican government. Of course, this was the case with other governments as well, but more so the Jamaican government. So Walter Rodney, after he attended a black writers' conference in Montreal in October, and when he returned to Jamaica on around October 15th, he was declared persona non grata. And when the students heard about this, they were upset because they were losing a lecturer who they liked. But unbeknownst to them, Walter Rodney had a constituency off the campus. So you had this constituency off the campus who encountered for the first time this large number of red-gowned students who went on the streets of Kingston to protest. And it is the convergence of the urban youth and the students, which creates a new situation in terms of a mass demonstration that turns violent in Kingston.
Mm-hmm.
And there are casualties, properties damaged, but it creates a new political awareness in the region and has an impact wider than Jamaica. and marks a turning point. It's the beginning of the radical 70s, so to speak.
But Rodney goes to Dar es Salaam. He goes back to Tanzania.
Rodney goes not directly to Tanzania. Mm. He spent some time in Cuba.
In Cuba, okay.
And apparently he wrote a manuscript, which we have not been able to identify, on the black struggle, reflecting on his experience. And certainly we intend to follow up to pursue that particular manuscript. He goes to England, and then he resettles in University of Dar es Salaam, mm-hmm, between 1969 and 1974.
Wrote the seminal How Europe Underdeveloped
Africa.
And
the genesis of that text is very interesting in that it really develops as a set of lectures to the Tanzanian teachers, the History Teachers Association. It goes throughout Tanzania discussing the problems that Tanzania faces in terms of trying to effect change. And he says that one needs to understand the problems in the broader way, in the concept, in the context of the European involvement with Africa over several centuries. And interestingly, he gives the manuscript to workers who were literate in English for them to read and to comment. And this is an indication of how seriously Rodney took the role of political education, mm-hmm, among working people. And he did the same in terms of his discussions with people in Jamaica and in the bottom house meetings in Guyana.
In Guyana.
Or elsewhere. So this was a way of operating. And hence, by 1972, we had his brilliant book, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa.
And he goes back to Guyana in 1974, expecting to get a job at the University of Guyana. Did not get a job. And what happens after then?
Well, he determines that he would not leave Guyana. He would stay. And he tried to get jobs even at the high school level. And the dictatorial Fos Burnham bans him, prevents him from getting a job there. But he decides to stay. He's not going to migrate. He doesn't take up offers elsewhere. And there are many offers. There are offers in Hamburg. There are offers in Canada. There are offers in the United States. He visits these places. He earns some money. He gets grants. He's able to research in the Guyanese archives. And he writes a very brilliant book on the history of the Guyanese working people, which is one of a fine historical work. And at the same time, he's involved with political activism in the Working People's Alliance. And this activism brings him and brings the working people into active confrontation with the Burnham regime. And it is this boldness and audacity of Walter Rodney which enlivens the opposition movement in Guyana, and which tragically leads to his death. And the death, in my view, was deliberately organized by the state, deliberately organized by the Burnham regime in order to eliminate a very bold opponent of dictatorial and
authoritarian regime. Were you able to confirm this in your research?
I was able to confirm from research that the Gregory Smith was an agent of the state and was set up with this bomb disguised as a walkie-talkie, and which was Walter's undoing, because when he tried out this instrument, it blew him apart.
When America wants to know what's happening in the Caribbean diaspora, there is one clear choice.
Hello, welcome to Carib Nation.
Both people inside and outside are
very excited about today's program.
Looking at you, I can tell that you've traveled the journey.
One television organization brings America close to the people, stories, and events that affects Caribbean life. Get close, get answers, get Carib Nation.
On any given Sunday, the Caribbean wakes up to a familiar sound. We enjoy traditional tastes. We share a friendly game, and like clockwork, we gather in a common place. And there, we hear a familiar voice.
Hello, welcome to Carib Nation.
Walter Rodney is sometimes referred to by what I call some malicious people as an ultra-leftist. Comment on that.
Well, I think the concept of ultra-leftist is not an adequate one in dealing with Walter Rodney. It is an attempt to marginalize him. It is an effort to say that he was out on some far left agenda that didn't really relate to the actual struggles and possibilities of African people and of Indian people and of working people generally. And he was making a challenge to them. And this is the whole purpose of the energy he put into political education, the energy he put into giving them the confidence that they could take on the agendas of transformation. Because the promises made to them by the political class that had emerged were promises that would founder on the class interests of the middle strata that was emerging in the Caribbean, and who were using the state as a basis for their economic consolidation.
What were some of the influences on his political thought?
Well, I would say that one of the key influences on political thought was C.L.R. James. Mm-hmm. And C.L.R. James, Walter had a great deal of respect for and was part of C.L.R. James's London study group in the mid-1960s. And C.L.R. James followed Walter's career throughout, corresponded with him. They had their differences, but I would put C.L.R. James as one of the critical Caribbean intellectuals. Mm-hmm. But I also mention another important Guyanese influence on Walter Rodney, and that is the late great mathematician and Africanist scholar Norman Cameron. Who was one of Walter's teachers at Queen's College in Guyana, mm-hmm. and who tends to be ignored. He's not well known, but he is a great classic scholar, a great mathematician, a great knowledge on African civilizations, and certainly that helped to shape Walter Rodney's early thinking on some of these topics.
As we come to the end of the 20th century, the Caribbean and the rest of the developing world face a strong challenge to their very existence as independent sovereign states. In the course of meeting this challenge, the working people are as vulnerable as never before. Globalization, structural adjustment, ethnic and racial competition, the doom varies, but the story is the same. It is at times like these that we must call upon the best in us to guide and inspire our struggle. In this regard, Walter Rodney is more relevant today than ever. And Dr. Rupert Lewis has given him to us in the form of a brilliant book, Walter Rodney's Intellectual and Political Thought. As a disciple of Rodney and a believer in something called the Caribbean Nation, I highly recommend this book. Until the next time, I'm David Ayn, thanking you for tuning in to yet another edition of Carib Nation. And remember, as always, our motto on this program is one people, one culture, one Caribbean, one nation. See you next time.